The Chicago Theater of the Air. Marion Clare, conducted by Henry Weber, written and directed by Jack LaFrandre, Mutual presents radio's greatest hour of music and drama, the famous Chicago Theater of the Air. Tonight's performance, Bittersweet, by Noel Coward, starring Nancy Carr, David Poleri, and Bruce Foote, with Marion Clare, Muriel Bremner, and Everett Clark in featured dramatic roles, and the chorus under the direction of Robert Trentler. Ladies and gentlemen, the first few minutes of the Chicago Theater of the Air each week are devoted to an informative address by Colonel Robert R. McCormick, noted historian, outspoken American patriot, and distinguished editor and publisher of the Chicago Tribune. Tonight, Colonel McCormick is to speak on the 175th anniversary of the Battle of Lexington. Ladies and gentlemen, Colonel Robert R. McCormick.
...175 years ago, in the chill New England dawn of April 19th, 1775... young William Diamond's drum beat the long roll at Lexington. The village belfry had already caught up and was repeating the alarm relayed through Charlestown and Cambridge, Medford and Menotomy. Now the bell of Lexington clamored to the bell of Concord. On Lexington Common, 77 men and boys, about half of the Captain John Parker's company of minutemen, farmers and villagers in their homespun garb, fell in to make a hopeful approximation of two ranks of well-drilled soldiery. At Buckman's Tavern on the village green, Paul Revere himself escaped from a British mounted patrol only an hour before, and having just seen John Hancock and Sam Adams safely away, went about the business of rescuing Hancock's trunk with its important papers. Looking down from an upper chamber of the tavern, Revere noted the flash and glitter of a British column of light infantry as it swung off the Concord Road and deployed into line of battle, facing the little company of minutemen. As Revere and Hancock's clerk, John Lawler, bundled the trunk toward a safer hiding place, they heard Captain Parker say, "Don't meddle with the regular troops, nor fight unless they insult us first." The British deployment was at double quick, practiced and deadly. Even so, there was time for Captain Parker to utter his immortal words, "Stand your ground. Don't fire unless fired upon. But if they mean to have a war, let it begin here." To this day, no one knows who fired the first shot at Lexington. I hope it was an American. In any case, the interval between time between peace and war ran swiftly out. It ended as Major Pitcairn of the Royal Marines roared his orders, "Disperse ye rebels! Ye villains, lay down your arms!" At Major Pitcairn's command, the Americans began to break ranks. Formal resistance was hopeless, and they knew it, but they did not lay down their arms. Some of the men moved off quickly, and others began a slow and sullen withdrawal. A few certainly refused either retreat or to give up their weapons. These last held their ground. Among them, old Jonas Parker, cousin to the captain. Jonas Parker placed his hat on the turf before him as a sign that he would not leave the field. He tossed his spare gunflints and extra rounds of ball into the hat at his feet. How many men stood with him, we do not know. The first shot was one of a confused flurry fired by unknown hands. One British platoon loosed a volley, perhaps intentionally, over the American head. The second platoon slammed its volley home at point-blank killing range. The British bayonets flashed down and went forward. Old Jonas Parker fired back. Other American muskets spoke, and the smoke drifted over the village green. Jonas Parker was on his knees, wounded and reloading, when the bayonets ended his battle. For the moment, the British light infantry seems to have gotten completely out of hand. The men rushed forward, shooting and stabbing, despite their officers' efforts to enforce discipline and maintain formation. Their own units scattered and severely mauled. Individual Americans forgot the rules of formal warfare to make an individual fight of it. A venomous rattle of sniping awoke from the nearby trees, houses, and fences. Men were hit in the British ranks. Major Pitcairn's horse was wounded. Then it was over as the British bugle sounded to cease firing. The clash at Lexington had not been foreseen in the orderly British plan for the day of April 19th. British objective was not Lexington, but a perfectly definite mission at Concord, where American leaders were known to be meeting, and where American arms and stores were hidden. Already hours late on the march and well aware that the countryside was rising, the British commander, Colonel Smith, was of no mind to continue a pointless skirmish and the pursuit of a few scattered colonials. The sight of 8 dead and 10 wounded Americans on the Lexington Common would serve to overawe any further resistance. Cursing the light troops for bringing on a clash contrary to plan, and indeed contrary to orders, for the British had hoped to avoid bloodshed, Smith and Pitcairn got their excited men back into formation. With the light infantry once more preceding the steadier grenadiers, the marching column of redcoats pushed on towards Concord. The first American blood was spilled at Lexington. The first American victory was won at Concord. At Concord, the church bell was already tolling the alarm. 2 companies of Concord Minutemen and 1 company from Lincoln were posted on a hill commanding the town when the British came in sight. These fell back before the regular to be joined by a 3rd company of Concord militia. A group of older men under the command of the Reverend William Emerson, Doctor of Divinity, whose grandson Ralph Waldo Emerson was to write the moving Concord hymn. Here once the embattled farmer stood and fired the shot heard round the world. The rude bridge was North Bridge over gentle Concord River. Across the bridge, the colonials halted and regrouped while the British occupied the town and rummaged through it for the arms and military stores they knew to be there. They found little. Both arms and stores had been spirited away. Exasperated, the redcoats set fire to town hall. Major Pitcairn intervened to order the fire extinguished. Yet the Minutemen, by now further reinforced by companies from nearby Acton and Bedford, it seemed that the British were intent on burning the entire village. If Concord were to be saved, it was perfectly plain that men must die to save it. With one accord, the Americans moved against the British force at the bridge. As it happened, the Acton Company led the advance, but all the colonials came on together. Some 450 Minutemen, muskets loaded and primed. Captain Isaac Davis of Acton, Colonel Robinson of Westwood, Major Butterick, whose family farm lay just beyond the bridge, these were in the van. At Major Butterick's side marched his young son, Pfeiffer of a company. The shrill music soared over the pond of many feet. The British pickets scrambled back. The fight at Concord Bridge was not to be a volley and a dispersal. The British fire was answered by heavy American volleys poured into the huddled defenders of the bridgehead. The British light infantry fought for perhaps 10 minutes of mounting desperation and confusion. Under increasing pressure, they began to scatter and fall back toward the road on which the Grenadiers were just coming up. Heartened by heavy infantry support, the British commander got off a frantic call for reinforcements and prepared for a desperate stand in Concord Village itself. That stand was not made. Having gained the initiative, the Americans very wisely drew back from Concord Bridge to wait their own reinforcements. For by now, the Bell of Concord had spoken to the Bell of Lincoln. Lincoln's bell had called out to Carlisle, Carlisle to Chelmsford. Acton and Westford had already sent their sons. Watertown and Western responded to the ever-widening clamor of alarm. Minutemen from Sudbury, Reading, and Billerica arrived on the field. Then the companies from Framingham and Woburn. More distant still in Worcester, Portsmouth, and the Marblehead, bells and drums called up the men. As far away at Pumfret, Connecticut, Big Israel Putnam left his plow in the furrow and got his command on the march. By noon, the British began their retreat from Concord back to Lexington. The retreat became a rearguard action as the Americans closed in. By Lexington, the British were fighting a costly running fight. After Lexington, despite heavy reinforcements, the retreat was a disastrous rout. The story of the British debacle I shall reserve for another time. I should, however, like to make certain comments on the exciting pages of our history we have just shared. First, as I have said, the British expedition was no random foray. The British knew the exact nature and importance of the ordnance, ammunition, and stores hidden at Concord. They knew because they'd been informed by Americans serving as British spies. The two principal spies were Benjamin Thompson of Woburn, a precocious Harvard intellectual of good family and excellent social conditions. How familiar that sounds today. The second informer was Dr. Benjamin Church, a highly respected and ultra-liberal figure in Boston, and a trusted member of the Committee of Safety. So cleverly did Dr. Church disguise his loyalties that only in recent years have we learned the full scope of his betrayals. It should be plain also that if the British expedition to Concord was no mere local raid, neither was the American resistance a spur-of-the-moment rally against armed oppressors. The Americans were well-armed, well-organized, and efficiently warned. They mustered with astonishing unanimity. They fought with superb resolution. Most accounts of Lexington and Concord tell of Captain Parker's company only in connection with the early morning clash at Lexington. That company, as we have seen, lost no less than 23% of its effectives. 18 men killed and wounded out of the field muster of 77. Losses in the neighborhood of 25% may well put highly trained units out of action. The Minutemen of Lexington were stout-hearted patriots indeed. Captain Parker's company, mustering its full strength of about 110 men, was again in action on fire-swept Concord Road when the retreating British stumbled back over the route of their morning's march. That is morale. The true significance of the day of April 19, 1775 was, of course, far greater than the importance of a British raid and the rout of the raiders at American hands. The fundamental British policy with regard to the American colonies rested on two fantastic assumptions. The first was that despite obvious and highly vocal urban discontent, the American farmer and the American populace generally were thought to be Tory in sentiment. The second misconception was that the Americans would run at the first sight of British troops in the field. In the history of the empire, few errors have ever been so stupid. None that I know about have been so inexcusable, so willfully ignorant, and so costly.
Speaking from the stage of the Chicago Theater of the Air, Colonel Robert R. McCormick, editor and publisher of the Chicago Tribune, has delivered another in his weekly series of radio editorials presented as a public service feature of this program. Three copies of tonight's address on the 175th anniversary of the Battle of Lexington may be obtained by writing to the Mutual Broadcasting System, Chicago 11, Illinois. Last week, we announced that all 14 chapters covering Colonel McCormick's recent flight to Europe, Africa, and Asia have been reprinted in a single pamphlet titled A Voyage to Three Continents. This pamphlet is available free to our listeners. The response to last week's announcement has been tremendous, and we repeat the offer again tonight. If you'd like a free copy of Colonel McCormick's Voyage to Three Continents, write a letter or postcard to the Mutual Broadcasting System, Chicago 11, Illinois. The curtain rises on tonight's Chicago Theater of the Air production of the Noel Coward operetta, Bittersweet, starring Nancy Carr, David Polleri, and Bruce Foote in singing roles, and featuring Marion Clare in the speaking role of Lady Shane, supported by dramatic players Muriel Bremner, Everett Clark, Maurice D. Copeland, and John Barclay. Noel Coward's Bittersweet.
Along the unpredictable road of life, there are many voices calling. Mysterious voices taunting from the shadows. Happy voices laughing in the sunlight. Bitter voices, sweet voices. But the dearest voice of all is the voice of love. I know this now, even though my voice of love is silent forevermore. When you've heard my story, perhaps you'll know it too. Yes, my voice of love is silent, but the memory will not die. Memory lingers still, like a golden sunset frozen in the sky.
Listen, hold you, here in my arms I will hold you, fears receding further and further away.
Ask why I insist on living in the past when my future looks so bright and secure. My marriage to Lord Shane was the talk of London, and as Lady Shane, I am the toast of some and the envy of many. Lord Shane is very good to me and understands perfectly. The day he proposed to me, he knew very well that my love is beyond mortal reach. In all fairness to Lord Shane, I must not live in the past, but he knows very well that I shall always dream in the past. Come with me back through the years, back to the days when Lady Shane was just plain Shari. I think you'll understand, too.
Thank you. I can't get over the improvement in your voice, Miss Shelley. It's been very noticeable in the past month.
Perhaps it's the inspiration of a great voice teacher, Mr. Linden.
Oh, yes, yes. But of course you took that high note too far in the back of your throat.
Oh, I wonder if I'll ever be able to sing properly.
I don't mean to find too much fault, Miss Shari, but... Well, I wrote this song for you when I was 16 years old. And I want it to be perfect.
But, Carl, I mean, Mr. Linden, how is that possible? You've only known me during the past year that you've been teaching me.
I've known you all my life, Miss Shari. Like a beautiful vision that's half earth and half heaven.
Mr. Linden, you've never talked like this before.
I know. Perhaps it's because it's spring. Perhaps it's because my very soul calls out against the drabness that is London and yearns for the beauty of the Austrian countryside, my countryside. Perhaps it's because you're going to marry Mr. Devon.
Mr. Linden, I don't understand what...
I'm sorry, Miss Shelley. I just envy you your love, that's all.
You do?
Yes. As I envy all young people who dance in the spring with love in their hearts. Gay colors sparkling in the sunlight. Old people sitting under the trees, tapping their sticks on the ground. Reviving in their hearts the memories of their youthful love.
You're homesick for Austria, aren't you, Mr. Linden?
Perhaps.
It's probably our London climate. It is depressing.
If only I could show you my country, Miss Shirley.
If only you could.
Though there may be beauty in this land of yours, skies are very often dull and gray. If I could but take this little hand of yours, just to lead you secretly. Would watch the Danube as it gently flows, like a silver ribbon winding free. Even as I speak of it, my longing grows. Once again, my own dear land to see. If you could only
to see Austria.
Well, with all the security Mr. Devon offers you, you'll be independent enough to see any country you like.
Mr. Linden, I mean...
Come, Miss Shelley. After all, this is a voice lesson. Your singing exercises. Just once more through.
Take a breath and then reprise in a different key. All my life I shall remember knowing you. All the pleasure I have found in showing you the different ways that one may praise the changing light and changing shade. Happiness that must die, melodies that must fly, memories that must fade, dusty and forgotten by and by.
Learning fails will never seem so sweet again.
Now, Miss Sherry, if you please, sing a scale for me. Take a breath and then reprise in a different key. All my life I shall remember. The pleasure I have found in showing you the different ways that one may phrase the changing light and changing shade, happiness that must die, melodies that must fly, memories that must fade, dusty and forgotten by and by.
With Mr. Devon, Miss Shari?
Carl, I don't love him.
What?
Can't you see that I... Oh, Carl.
Shari, then...
I don't care anything about Hugh Devon's security. I don't care if you don't have a penny to your name. We'll work, Carl. You can play and I can sing. We'll go to your Vienna and start our own lives. The kind of lives we want them to be.
Sorry, darling.
Oh, Carl, what is love? Does anyone really know?
My darling, we'll spend our lives answering that question.
Tell me, what is love? Is it some consumed? Is the moment of breaking, sky?
The memory lingers still. It cannot fade away. For 5 wonderful years, Carl and I were deliriously happy in our love. Even though Schlick's Cafe in Vienna, where Carl led the orchestra and I sang, was not among the better places in the city. Many rowdy soldiers came to Schlick's and demanded a lot of attention from the girls who were hired to entertain them.
Ladies of the town, ladies of the town, for we've got a confessional in.
Soldiers who came to Schlick's was a boisterous, swaggering bully named Captain August. I tried my best to avoid him, but every chance he got, Captain August made advances toward me, and his insinuations frightened me.
Oh, ho. Do not turn away, Fräulein Schari. It is not fair to refuse my eyes a glimpse of such a beautiful, alluring creature.
Captain August, please. I'm the singer here. I'm not paid to fraternize with a guest. You understand, don't you? I'm married to the orchestra leader.
So? That makes you even more interesting, Fräulein. That which is forbidden, Captain August takes. You will join me in this wine?
No. No, please, Captain August. It's time for my next song.
A song? I will sing, Fräulein. A toast to you, my little Charlie. And the wine we will drink together. Yeah?
I will not drink with you, Captain. I will not!
Hey, the golden sunshine of a summer day. Okay, we'll bear the burden of your cares away. Here's to the love in you, the hate in you, desire in you.
When in the sun of a walk you along, lifting your eye on the wind of a song.
Who dreams in you, the flame in you, the fire in you. The hate in you, desire in you.
Why does the sun ever want you along? Lifting you high in the wings of the storm.
The dreams in you, the flame in you, the fire in you.
Okay, okay. So while we get the best we borrow, then the wine we want to borrow and to sing.
Okay, the only call we all obey. Okay.
Shari, are those tears I see?
What's the matter, darling?
I'm frightened, Carl. Can't we leave this place?
Leave?
Please, darling. They expect me to be like the other girls here. When men like Captain August try to put their arms around me, I'm frightened.
Shari, look at me. Do you think I'd ever let anything happen to you?
When you look at me like that, Oh, Carl, do we have to stay here at Schlick's? Our love had been so full, darling. So complete.
It will remain complete, Charlene.
Hold me close, darling.
Peace enfold you. Here in my arms I will hold you. Fears receding further and further away. Divide us, and ill fortune betide us, yet our love is a token that cannot be broken or stolen away.
We'll leave this place, Charlie. We'll leave tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Oh, Carl, could we?
We have a little money saved. We'll go to Budapest. Tonight will be our last night at Schlick's. We'll open our own cafe.
Our own cafe. Oh, Carl, how shall we manage it? And may I sing your songs then?
I wouldn't have it otherwise.
Contrive to remain independent.
We'll have a meek reputation and a chic clientele. Kings will wonder at them.
Oh, we'll be so zealous that the world will be
reputation and a chic clientele. Kings will fall under our spell.
Oh, we'll be so zealous that the world will be jealous of our sweet little happy
right now.
So do I, darling. But the night will soon be over. We must finish our jobs here in good faith.
This night seems endless. It seems as though we're standing on the brink of a new dawn.
A new dawn and a million tomorrows, Shari, when we leave here tonight. A new world is waiting for us.
A new world and a love that will never grow old. Home and pack after one more song. I can hardly wait to get started.
All right, darling. This will be your last professional appearance here at Schlick's. Two choruses will be enough.
I'll kiss you, Fräulein. I'll kiss you as you have never been kissed before.
No, no. Let go of me, Captain August.
Sorry, what's happened?
He tried to kiss me, Carl. He tried to kiss me.
Why, you filthy, ill-mannered, drunken swine. Here's the kind of kiss you deserve.
Carl! So, your fine-mannered orchestra leader chooses to insult Captain August, does he? Well, you shall be answered.
No. Look out, Carl. He has a sword.
Stand back, Charlie. Stand back.
Here is your answer, musician.
I know your love would want me to. I'll sing your songs wherever people will listen to me. Wherever they will listen on the face of the earth.
The sensational new prima donna, Shari Lindon, takes Paris by storm.
Thank you.
great success in New York.
Oh, they may cheat you and deceive you. Your youth must answer to the homeland.
Soprano star Shari Lindon comes home to London.
Come in, Lord Shane. Come in.
A little tired of the company?
Never. I just thought I'd like to be alone with your piano for a while. That's all.
Shari.
I know what you're going to say, Henry.
You should. I propose to you in every country in Europe.
Why should London prove the exception, then?
It's home, Shari. Crocuses in the park in the springtime, and children searching for horse chestnuts in the fall.
Home.
And snug, crackly fires in the winter that dissipate the yellow gloom outside and illuminate the shivering trees that look in at you like ghosts.
Ghosts?
What is it, Charlie?
Oh, it's nothing. I must tell you, Henry. I've only loved one man in all my life. I know it must seem tiresome to you to have me so faithful to a memory.
Oh, but I understand, Shari. I wouldn't want you to be any different. All I ask is a chance to share what happiness we both have left.
Bless you, Henry Shane. Sometimes the world has strange ways of bringing people together. Carl once wrote a song about a lovely flaxen-haired princess who fell in love with a zigeuner, a gypsy. Maybe his song wasn't just fancy, Henry.
Shari, darling, from this moment on, our gypsy days are over.
Thank you. hour and the day, Shari. Forever and ever.
Yes, Carl. Forever and ever.
Shari. Oh, once more alone with her memories. Invading such dreams is like invading a holy sanctuary.
Along the unpredictable road of life, there are many voices calling. Bitter voices, sweet voices. But the clearest voice of all is the voice of love.
Conducted by Henry Weber, written and directed by Jack LaFondre, the Chicago Theatre of Beer has presented Noel Coward's operetta favorite, Bittersweet, starring Nancy Carr as Shari, David Poleri as Carl, Bruce Foote as Captain August. Featured speaker was Colonel Robert R. McCormick. Robert Trendler was in charge of the chorus. Performance rights were granted by Thames Whitmark Music Library. Heard in synchronized speaking roles this evening, Marion Clare as Lady Shane, Muriel Bremner as Shari, Everett Clark as Carl, John Barclay as Lord Shane, Maurice D. Copeland as Captain August. This is Lee Bennett cordially inviting you to next week's Chicago Theater of the Air production, The Gypsy Princess by Emmerich Kallman, starring Nancy Carr and Richard Tucker. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.